Hello, I'm Peter Wilson. I'm the chair of the Lifestyle and Cardiometabolic Health Council at the American Heart Association. And I'm here in San Francisco with one of our keynote lecturers for this meeting, Dr. Lawrence Beilin. Welcome.
Thank you. Very pleased to be here. I'm really honored to be invited to give this David Kritchevsky Memorial Lecture. It's very exciting to come here again.
And you're from Australia, right?
That's right, from Perth in Western Australia.
Yep. Well, that's a long way, as you certainly have a good chance to win the distance award this year.
Yeah, okay.
Tell us about what you plan to address and generally about your research that you've been conducting in Australia.
Okay. Well, I'm going to talk about lifestyle and diet and high blood pressure and its importance, and also something about the search for the elixir of life that everybody seems to be demanding.
Well, one of the questions I think comes up in our Lifestyle Council is the relative comparisons of what might lifestyle do versus a blood pressure medicine. I have patients I put on thiazide diuretics, calcium blockers, and others. Give me some sort of relative weight of what works.
Okay. Well, I must say, I got into this also because as a physician, I was frustrated with the side effects people were getting from tablets, the fact people didn't want to take drugs. And so over the years, we've been studying and trying to find out actually what works and what works if you add to effects of drugs or if you can substitute for drugs. And I think the answer to your question as to what's the equivalent, it depends whether you can get people to change their lifestyle adequately. And in terms of what really works, there are a number of things we know that will reduce blood pressure in what I would call proof of principle studies. In addition to sodium restriction, which of course has long been there, is weight reduction, increased physical activity, moderation or reduction in heavy alcohol consumption, and eating the right kind of foods. So all of those things independently will reduce blood pressure in somebody who's got high blood pressure by about 5 millimeters of mercury, systolic, which is about half of what you might get from a single drug therapy. But if you combine two of those lifestyle factors, particularly anything added to weight control, if you add weight and sodium restriction, or weight and exercise, or weight and alcohol moderation in heavy drinkers, then you can get something like a 10 millimeter mercury plus blood pressure reduction, which is equivalent to that of a drug. If you take the so-called DASH diet, increased fruit and vegetables, and all the reduction of heavy meat consumption, reduction of saturated fats, then in hypertensives, just from that DASH combination diet, they got 11 millimeters of mercury blood pressure reduction. So there are a lot of different things that will work together, which in mild hypertensives will give you the equivalent of a single drug. The problem is, of course, getting people to stick to these regimes. And when you get out into the community, you don't get usually as big an effect as you do with single drugs. But at a population of level, of course, you can get major effects, major shifts in population blood pressure, which can have enormous effects on the outcomes in terms of stroke risk and heart attack risk.
So, it's interesting, the American Heart Association, we have Life Simple 7 as part of our 2020 goals, and as I was counting in my head, I think you have four or five of our seven key factors in blood pressure, feeding into blood pressure, so to speak. I'm going to ask a question that you may say you don't want to answer, but if I were to prioritize with my patients, and I typically have somebody who's 10 or 20 pounds overweight, and they have many of these issues, where should I start if I was going to work on five? Is there any way to prioritize?
Okay, well, again, it depends on your patient. If they're a smoker, my number one priority would be to get them to stop smoking. Now, that may not have a very big effect on blood pressure acutely. We still don't quite know about that. But in terms of reducing their overall cardiovascular risk, and of course their risk of cancers and lung disease. Smoking cessation, I think, is still the number one priority. But of course, if you do that in hypertensive, you've then got to stop them putting on weight. So almost at the same time, you have to get them into some way of increasing physical activity and balancing their calorie consumption so that they won't put on weight. And once they've got off smoking, then you focus on the other priorities. So if you come to the non-smoker, again, I think it depends on the individual. If they're overweight, I would probably put getting weight under control as the number one priority by a combination of increased physical activity and eating more sensibly and initially cutting down those portion sizes. There's no way, if you eat the standard portion you get served in a diner in San Francisco or elsewhere in the States or even in Australia now, that you're going to lose weight. And you've only got to do that two or three times a week, and all your attempts at calorie restriction the rest of the week will go out. I'll just bring you another one, because I said it depends on the individual. I don't know about here currently, but there are a lot of heavy drinkers in Australia, and I think there are quite a few in America. If they are heavy drinkers, getting their alcohol intake down will substantially lower their blood pressure. We've got very good evidence for that. And of course, it'll also reduce their risk of a number of cancers, which people don't realize is a major risk of alcohol.
So one of the things I think we grapple with in taking care of patients and taking care of the population is who should be the message bearer and who should be the person trying to lead them. For instance, it sounds like you're especially emphasizing the patient health practitioner relationship rather than trying to change sodium in the diet and other issues. Flavor? Or maybe it's all and you've largely focused on...
I focused on it because I answered your question. You said, what should I do if a patient came in? What would be my priorities? No, I think you've got to have a multi-pronged approach to this. And I think a major role for the doctor is an advocate to the public, to health agencies and to politicians in particular, to try and develop measures that will make it easier for the community to deal with the cultural and social issues we have that are putting weight up, keeping blood pressure up, enabling a lot of people, not enabling, but particularly in developed and developing countries, encouraging smoking rates to increase still.
Right.
So I think, yes, you know, the political, the social, the industrial side of this is absolutely crucial. There's a very limited extent to what we can do with patients. And there was a wonderful paper presented by one of the young investigators this morning showing the difference between what you gain by a population-wide approach compared with an individual patient approach. And in fact, you gain more with a population approach, but you've got to have a dual approach.
Right. Right. Well, thank you very much. Thank you for your time. And we certainly enjoy having you here at our meetings, though, and look forward to hearing you tomorrow morning when you deliver your lecture. And I'm still hoping to find out exactly what this elixir of a long life and less hypertension for me and my patients really might be. So this is Peter Wilson from the American Heart Association. Thank you for being with us.